Welcome to another chapter of In the Keep podcast. I'm your very own prophet of the drowned god, the Motherlode. The Keep is a collective of gaming enthusiasts compelled by the drowned god Cathala to frag and jib one another into oblivion for all eternity. If you haven't already heard the good news, allow me to be the one to bring it to you. TastySpleen.tv has just announced the QCon at Home Tasty Cup Classic Series. This is 3 days of 1v1 action, and signups are open now. You can go check it out on Twitter to get the full schedule, but essentially it's going to be day one, Doom 2 1v1 tournament, day two, Quake World 1v1 tournament, day three, Quake 2 1v1 tournament. It's going to be kick ass. I can't wait to see what kind of awesome action we get out of this. Be sure to go over to Tasty Spleen, however you get there, it doesn't matter, Twitter, their website, tastyspleen.tv, and get in on this shit, man. Be on their Twitch stream that day. Support the hell out of this, because this is what we need. In a time like this, we can't all go to QuakeCon because it ain't happening, and we need to be supporting these awesome games and the awesome streamers and creators and everyone who's involved. It's going to be bad ass. You heard it from me. Now that that's over, let's go ahead and take some time to introduce this week's guest. It is Théo Touhety. I hope I'm not butchering that, but yeah, hey, je ne parle pas le français très bien. So, it is what it is, man. But anyway, you could also call him Todos, that's his name online. But he is an awesome game developer for Blazing Stick, is his company. They're creating an amazing, amazing game called Cyberhook. I've played the demo, you should play the demo too. It's available on Steam right now. It's amazing. If you like Quake Defrag, if you like parkour, if you like grappling hooks and swinging around like fucking Spider-Man or whatever, if you like retro wave, if you like retro aesthetic and the amazing, you know, graphics that come with that, you are going to absolutely love this game. If you like speedrunning, you're going to love this game. There's a million things to like about this game. I very much see a lot on the horizon, so much potential here. But also, Théo is just a really cool guy, man. We had a fantastic chat. He's also a professor of game development over at IsArt Digital in Paris, France. And wow, like, that's fucking awesome. And we got a chance to really dig into the pros and cons of getting an education if you want to be a game developer and everything. This is a fun chat. I really hope you enjoy it. And we're going to play a little bit of music here from the soundtrack to Cyberhook. So listen to that, enjoy it. And when it's over, we'll be in the Keep with Théo Touhety.
People, I'm Théo. I've been working on Cyberhook for the past 3 years, alone, and 1 year, the last year. I've received help from two of my friends, Arthur Peralta for level design and Thomas Tia for music. Other than that, I'm a new indie developer and teacher at my old video game school, IsArt. So if you want, you might catch me in Paris teaching some young kids how to not fail at video games, and me, myself, failing to do that.
There's a movie called The School of Rock with Jack Black, and there's this, he's like essentially posing as a substitute teacher, and he is sitting at the table with all these other teachers, and he starts making like these dumb teacher jokes to try to impress all the other teachers, make them think he's really a teacher. So he says, those who can't do, teach. And those who can't teach, teach gym. And I don't know why I always remembered that, but like, when, you know, I also do some teaching too. I do meteorology as my kind of day job, and so I teach a lot of like young students, like how, you know, to forecast the weather and all that. And I really do understand, like, it. I feel like I don't know anything until I start teaching someone, and then it makes me, you know, I feel like you could, everybody who's ever been in a teaching position can kind of relate to that.
Yeah. The same for game development. I say it in French, but it crystallizes your knowledge. You need to make it compact and easy to teach, essentially. So yeah, it does help me actually in my games to tell other people how to do it.
Yeah.
So since I'm quite young, sometimes I even teach to people older than me. So that's pretty cool. And I need to teach like my dad how to freaking code and stuff like that. But yeah, I need to be prepared for that.
So what in your childhood sent you on this journey of becoming a game developer?
That's a good question. I always was into games, like really, really fucking always. I think I started playing Link's Awakening, Wind Waker. Mm-hmm. Not Wind Waker, I'm not. Zelda, Link's Awakening, mm-hmm. Sorry. Was 3, and when you're 3, you can't read. And I remember asking my sisters to read me some dialogues, and they didn't want to do that, so I just blinded my way through the game, through half the game. Started from early childhood. I was always playing games, anything I could find, I played. And when I reached high school, the end of high school, when I was like 15 or 14, I've had my first TI calculator, and I know from friends that usually that's how it starts. You get to code just a little bit on it, maybe like I don't remember how I did it. I think it was for cheating, stuff like that, because my teachers didn't check the calculators, so I could just make a small program giving me all the answers. So that started like that. Then I tried Minecraft modding really while back, like it was in the beta. I lost everything, but it captivated me. So after finishing high school, I was looking for new stuff to do, like in what university to go. I think it's pretty much the same in France. And I found my school that I teach in now, which is art. Which is art. And I went there and worked and learned how to do game design and programmation, coding essentially. And once that was done, the school actually changed location in Paris, and we I think that's where a new incubator opened, and we were selected with a few of my friends to work there and to just do a very small game, which I'm not going to tell the name of because it's trash, like really trash. It's a small Mario Party game essentially, when you have a map with a few blocks, and when you step on a block, it falls. Pretty much it. No interest. But after doing that and releasing on Steam, most of our friends actually went to find real jobs. And I stayed around because I just wanted to see if I could actually make it in as an indie developer. So at that point, it was 3 years ago, I started a small project called Cyberhook. Well, at the time, it wasn't called that. Like, I think it was Sparkhook, something like that. Anyway, I just wanted to try out the grappling physics in Unity, and with my little coding experience, 5 years I think back, I tried to make a small rope bend around the level, and so on and so on. Every time I wanted to try out something, I tried it in the product. And I realized like 1-2 years ago, well, damn, that's if we can do a game with that. And a few of my friends just pushed me and said, yeah, go for it. And I've been essentially working on it for the past 3 years, like I said, and here we are with a almost finished game, which kind of looks like a real game that I'm not ashamed of showing. So yeah, that's pretty much all my dev experience and how I got into game making.
I think I've made a mistake. You said you made Cyber Hook, like a grappling game?
Yeah.
I thought this was Cyber Hooker, the groping game. I'm sorry. Okay.
Actually, you made the joke, but at first when we released on Steam, I was being a stalker and I just I typed Cyberhook almost every day to see if we were in the Google search results. And yeah, the first thing was Cyberhooker. So I'm like, maybe change the name or something. Luckily, with the exposure from the Steam Festival, we went up into the research results, and now no more hookers. Yay, we are a real game.
So, I think I first saw Cyberhook sometime, it was a while back. It must have been 6 months ago or something. And I was like, "Who the hell made this game? I need to get in contact with this person." And just seeing photographs and like the basic description of it and everything, and this like really captivated me. So what was like your inspiration for Cyberhook? Because for me, this immediately, the first thing I thought when I looked at it is like, this is essentially like Quake Defrag plus a grappling hook, which I love. So, and I wasn't even a big Defrag guy, but I mean, like, I just like the concept of it, and I'm like, this is new, this is different, because it's never really been made into its own kind of game before in that way. What were your inspirations? Where do you come from?
Yeah, I actually have many different ones. First of all, I made it into neon retrowave style, like synthwave, for two reasons. Because I actually was getting into the genre, like music-wise, and just liking the aesthetics in general. Mm-hmm. And the other reason was because it was actually doable. Because like I said before, I was joined by Arthur and Thomas for both level design and music. Mm-hmm. And I did not say art. Yeah, there are no artists in the game, in the team, and I'm not one. I can't draw for shit, and I can't texture anything. So I thought that it was actually a good idea to do this simple style. If you look at the game, it's just blocks with the little borders colored, which is actually really, really hard to do. It was tricky. But the more I progressed into this genre, the more I pushed, the more I actually fell in love with it. I went around looking for references on the internet, and I found both musical, that's a big part, but musical references that inspired me to add darker or cooler elements in the game. The environment was based on a few artworks that we usually see when searching synthwave and stuff. But it's really a mashup of multiple things. You know, Far Cry Blood Dragon, which is
I love that game. Like, that's the only Far Cry game I even like, to be honest with you.
because the idea was not giving a shit, pretty much. Mm-hmm. It's just do the game, have fun, and that's the vibe I went with, pretty much. I don't recall really precise references, because every time I did something was because it taught me something new. Like I learned how to do shaders with the project, how to do texturing and environments with it, and because it was not that hard to do, because I couldn't do anything that required drawing in any way. I couldn't do anything that that was very much skillful in terms of art. If you see, for example, when you run in the game, you see your hands moving around. Yeah. It's all cubes. It's all simple geometry. And the one thing I could work on that I love, actually, the thing I love in video game is animations. So it's all curves, it's all positioning. So I have been able to work on it a lot. And that there is no real inspiration for that. It's just me just putting out in the game all my animation ideas. And it makes a new thing. Not really new. It makes new with old, pretty much. That's the thing we also teach our students.
I believe the scholarly term is like neo-retro, something along that line. Yeah, like it's new, but it's emulating something from the past. Yeah,
that's a new word for me, but I knew it all along.
Yeah,
I was testing if you were listening. That's what I tell my students when I don't know the something.
I usually bring people on the podcast and just wait for them to stop talking so that I get my chance to just tell them what I think.
Well, yeah, that was pretty much it for the inspiration.
No, I don't think that's the full story. There's no way. Like, there had to be something that you saw that inspired the gameplay mechanics themselves. Like, this is not just the aesthetic. It's a beautiful aesthetic. I'm a huge fan of Retrowave. Just the way it looks. Obviously, I have a whole podcast about retro video game stuff. I love Retrowave music. Like, Ghost Ship is a really great artist that I like got super into. He got me through math classes because just it's calm, chill music. But it's like it back in a big way, especially in the gaming scene, because it vibes so well with a lot of the aesthetic of the games that are coming out. John of the Shred is like killing it right now, and that he's known for that kind of music. And I think he got like a contract with WWE or some shit right before COVID hit. Like, the retro wave thing is happening, so it's good that
I think so too.
This is really interesting. You said you've been working on this game for 3 years, so there's basically no way you could have seen the retro shooter genre taking off, the retro wave genre taking off, this aesthetic kind of really becoming popular in gaming, and you've kind of like happened into the perfect time for it.
Yeah, for that it was just luck. But if you want to know the inspiration for the mechanics, there is one actually. I remember telling my friends like when I was really young, like 12 or 11. Mm-hmm. I don't remember. That someday I wanted to do something with grappling hook. I remember dreaming about that shit and not flying, because flying it's just bland. Just the default dream that you do when you're young, just fly. All right, but I wanted to grapple to stuff because it's more precise, it's more energetic, I guess, dynamic. And I remember wanting to do that. And so when I got the opportunity to just have some free time and do something, the first thing that came to my mind was just, I want to grapple to shit. So I remember doing a small prototype that I am not going to show anyone because it's complete trash. Really, it's unplayable and stuff. But at the time, I remember being amazed by it. So with Cyberhook, I've been able to work that into a real game. And I also got into speedrunning a while back. I think it was like 6-7 years ago. Anyway, I saw people actually breaking games and finding glitches in the levels to go through faster, and I was really into it. Like it's the core of speedrunning is to being able to play with the game, not just playing the game. And I thought, just make the game, make a grappling hook game where you can break the level design at will. And that's what we see in our community, that we have speedrunners just destroying levels. Yeah. But most of the time it'd be a bad thing for developers. But for us, just that's awesome, they're breaking the game.
I can think of is that there's a level where you have all these sort of large rectangular spires, and that's the whole level essentially until you get to the end of it. And I really quickly, like, me and my friend were playing it, and we were like both like looking at each other like, I'm pretty sure we could, you could just skip this whole part and jump straight past it and save yourself so much time. And that's like what's really exciting about the game, is like, because you can constantly figure out new ways to use the physics to your advantage. I love that, man. Such a genius idea, even if it wasn't intentional.
Most of it was actually, we wanted to do that pretty much. Just let the player figure out things. Arthur, level designer, is sometimes a bit annoyed by it because, he spent a lot of time working on most of the levels. So having it broken in one go is kind of annoying. But it's actually a debate we're having in with the community, because people like it, but sometimes it's just way too one dimensional, I guess, because some levels are just find a way to spin around and launch yourself to the finish line. So right now, the build I taught you about right before recording this, I've sent a new build to the community where I nerfed that. So it's going to be a bit tricky, but the good thing is it's always back and forth with the community. Like I told them that I was going to nerf that by adding up some more drag when you're airborne, so you are going to lose speed when you're going really fast. But if they don't like it, that goes to the trash, and I find something else. So yeah, the game wasn't born like it is in one go. It's a lot of back and forth. For example, in the game, you can double jump, you can time warp, you can hook and double jump again and again. You can essentially fly with a hook. But at the beginning, like 1.5 years, a year ago, when we were still in alpha, you had one single double jump. And well, even before that, you didn't have any double jump. You barely had any time warp. The time warp didn't work properly. And it's always with feedback from the community, from the players, that we just tweak something. Because we might be game devs, and my students tell me that. And like, you're game dev, you are the designers, you can do anything. No. Most of the time, you do what you can do with the time you have and stuff like that, with the ideas you have. And yeah, we added a lot of new things from the feedback that we got from the community, and the game grew like that. So yeah, it's a pleasure to have more people playing the game right now. I don't really know where we're headed.
Yeah.
What was the basic question? I'm just talking. Sorry.
I'm just talking about, like, you know, what inspired you to make game mechanics the way they are. And I see where you're coming from.
Yeah. Yeah. The inspiration also comes from the players.
Yeah.
Because you give me an idea, I find it cool. It's my inspiration now. Ha!
Yeah.
I steal it.
I think it's really interesting how you're talking about people finding out ways to kind of basically cheat the whole level. And for me, that was just part of the beauty of it. And it seems that, you know, as your skills improve, you know, you get to a point where, like, oh, now I can actually get past this area, which you find things that you previously thought were impossible, and then you figure out a way around it. And I think that's a really fun thing. And it's also because you don't have, like, hard, medium, you know, difficult. It's like what's the best way? It's like when you're a kid and they have, like, a set of monkey bars that are for the little kids, and they have another set of monkey bars that are for the big kids, and you can look at them both at the same time and decide which one you want to tackle. Like,
yeah. And one thing we wanted to do in the game is one pitfall that new developers fall into, I guess, is designing their game for just one target audience,
right?
And most of the time it's just a hardcore gamer, because I'm a real game dev and I'm going to make a game for the big boy gamers. That's bad, because everyone is allowed to enjoy your game at any time. You shouldn't just say, no, you're not skilled enough, no, you're not good enough, fuck off. So that's why in the game we added a few things to make it really, really easy. In the end, you can time warp. When you time warp, you're frozen in place. You gain more range with your hook.
Right.
You have double jumps. You can do anything. But, well, you can use that and have fun at your own pace. And it's perfectly fine. It's perfectly valid. And we would be happy to hear that you enjoy the game just taking it slow. It's fine. But that's true. What you just said is true. If you want to go faster, if you want to get better, you can do that. You can simply not use the time warp at all.
Yeah.
You don't use the time warp. You gain a shit ton of time. You get some speed. You get momentum. You can find ways, different ways of tackling a level. And just doing that will make you better. But you don't have to. You don't have to be in the top 10, top 20 of the leaderboard. I think there isn't even an achievement for that. Because while it's good to reward those that put in the work, we want to do that. It's not great to tell others, yeah, you just trash fuck off. Because they deserve to have fun too. So the game was based around this idea that anyone can have fun, but if you want to try, you can. You don't have to, but you can.
What engine is this built in?
All Unity.
So
on Unity. Yeah.
I could see conceivably like where you could just perpetually like the way that this physics engine currently works, and I'm sure it's going to improve over time. The way that you've got it set up, I could see you just continually releasing more and more content, or even opening it up to the community to make maps. And there could be a fucking Cyberhook, you know, World Series at some point. Like that, you know, I was really shooting far, but I could see a lot of fun in this because they already have, like, you have the Defrag World Cup, you have, you know, people playing Infinirace and Warfork. People really like this kind of thing. People like, you know, speedrunning competitions or just it is exactly the type of game that I think has a lot of room for competition. You already have the leaderboard.
Oh, yeah.
So you know who the 10 best players are going to be. Invite them all. I'll do it. I do this kind of shit all the time anyway. I'll find the 10 best players and be like, hey, you guys are all going to have a competition and we're going to, like, that could be so much fun. And really set yourself up for success in that regard.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, you know, there is some stuff planned for that. Mm-hmm. For now, the official stuff we are going to release is going to be a marathon mode, where you every month you get a selection of 10 different levels, the same for everyone, and you can just play each of them in a row without the timer ever stopping, ever resetting. So if you die, that's time loss. If you just wait around, that's time loss. And at the end, you get a big one single time for the 10 levels. But we can definitely tell people, those 10 levels or those 10 levels, today you're going to be challenged on it. So that's a possibility, clearly, and we don't want to.
Free community testing for your levels, so you can decide which ones to put in your game. Yeah,
actually, yes. There are a lot of bugs that were found by the community. So I'm always sweating when I found one because that shouldn't be happening, and that's not my fault. But it's great. Other thing is, opening to the community would be awesome. But, and that's always the same thing, and it tortures me, really. We don't have enough time. Like I said, I'm saying we because of Arthur and Thomas that work on the game, but right now I'm alone. I'm just one guy working on it, having to do a Switch build. Hell. having to do a Switch build, having to fix the levels, working with a publisher that wants new builds and new fixes all the time. And my goal would be to actually finish the game, add a big thing for the end, not going to spoil anything. But the other thing is a level editor, because you know the game is all blocks, really. Even for me, it's simple because I can't spend time making complex levels. So it's all blocks with four different colors. So it's not hard for people to get into it and build something. I don't care. Being able to do that would open up a great deal of community content and clearly push the game forward. Yeah. But it's tricky for me to do it simply because I don't have time. So for now, the roadmap for me is just finishing the game, releasing hopefully Q3, mm-hmm. autumn of this year, and being able to give a product that is pretty much finished, the best of my abilities, I guess. Mm-hmm. And if people are actually into it, and if I can live off it, because 3 years not being paid is kind of hard to sustain. If people can get into it, I'd be fucking pumped to make DLCs and to make a level editor free of charge. I don't know yet, but adding stuff afterwards is definitely a possibility. But right now, I'm just one man. Stop telling me to make a final boss. I can't. I want to do it. I want to do it, but I can't. Don't have time.
So, let's kind of explore like the narrative, because it's very vague, at least in the demo. We just have this idea, like, it's so vague. It's like, they suck, and you got to do something about it. And here's the hook, and, you know, get after it. And then just, I like how it introduces you to the skills, each individual skill, level by level, and then it just kind of sets you free to go nuts.
The tutorial as it is not entirely finished. I'm going to add a few things just to ease the players in the game, but it's a good placeholder for people to get into the game right now. The scenario, the narration is very bare bones, kind of wingly, like kind of on purpose right now, mm-hmm. because it's just a beta. I don't want to spoil the whole scenario outright, but there are two things about the scenario. I'm going to put one in. Just I have all of it written down, no problem. I'm going to fully fledged it on release, but it shouldn't be mandatory. Like I said, everyone can have fun. If you don't give two shits about the scenario, you just want to run around, it's fine.
Yeah,
really. So it's not going to. There's not going to be any decisive. What's the term? Decision making or anything. But we want to add some new narration, and I can spoil it a little bit. We have a few ideas left and right. But the idea is the little robot that you find in the game, Drone, yeah. Is actually someone. Trapped here. Spoilers, she's an ally. I've had people being doubtful about it, but yeah, she's on your side. But clearly, there is no enemy outright in the game. Well, shown. But right. There is someone. I can't really tell more of it, because there are no ints in the game. Maybe a few, but nothing much. But We have stuff prepared. We have stuff prepared, but I don't want to spoil anything for two reasons. It's spoilers, and I don't have time. So if I can't put it in the game, why spoil it? It's just going to be a fake lie. Like, there's a final boss. It's awesome. It's never going to happen. Thanks. No. But yeah, no spoilers.
So you keep saying, like, I don't have the time. Are you, like, strictly on a schedule, like Blazing Stick's holding you to, like, you have to have it out by this point? Or
No. Blazing Stick, it's just me. Okay,
that's what I thought. I was just kind of, like, trying to figure out. Who's holding you accountable?
It's Graffiti Games, our publisher, which is cool. It's cool to have a release date and planned marketing. But since they have planned marketing and stuff like that, they can't just tell, hey, two more months.
Yeah.
Well, I say that, and we've been delayed 6 months with COVID and stuff. But yeah, also for me, I don't have time, because working for free for myself, for exposure, it's cool, but I can't sustain that. I started working on this game when I was 22, mm-hmm. And I am almost 25. I'd like to move out of the house of the parents. I'd like to have my home. I'd like to have a car, something like that. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's a lot of investment for myself and stuff like that. And I'd like to, well, I told you that I was teaching. So all the money I made from teaching went back into the game.
Right.
That's what I used to pay Arthur and Thomas. But now I'm just alone, because yeah, there's no more money, and I don't want to put more of my own earnings into it.
Right.
And I think I spent like 20k. But just
investing in yourself, and that's good. So you should be doing at this age.
And the idea is, I do that because I love it. I wouldn't spend 20k just for the exposure, or because I'm going to get rich making games. Spoilers, no. But. Yeah, it's just something I want to do, and like you said, it's an investment for myself. I already plan I have plans for another game, stuff like that, with better organization, with better budget and stuff like that. But if Cyberhook works, I'm definitely keep working on that because I love the game, and that's something that not a lot of devs are going to say openly. But most of the games or the projects you work on, if it goes past 1 year, you start hating it because you are always facing your old mistakes, your old code and stuff like that. It's just trash. But with Cyberhook, I've actually took the time necessary to have a clean project, to have a decent working project, and it's pretty much all me. So I'm always down for working more on it, but I need to sustain myself.
Yeah,
it's becoming critical, pretty much. And we can't all be Toby Fox releasing Undertale and being a fucking millionaire.
Yeah,
oh, I'm jealous.
Have you tried crowdsourcing at all? You have a Patreon page and all this sort of stuff.
We haven't. Yeah. We haven't
I think
yet.
You should.
Maybe someday. Yeah, but I'm still new to the idea of having people pay for my game, because for now we only had like one game on Steam that made $500. Yeah, 1 year of work, $500. But we'll see how the community receive the game, and if there's actually a push for more content, maybe I'll steal a bit of money from my players.
I think you should, man. I don't think there's any reason. I think you're only doing yourself a disservice by not already having that out there, because I'm sure there's people that support this podcast. There's people that support you as a developer, and knowing that you're literally killing yourself working, you know, for 3 years with no pay and putting parts of your life on hold to get this game out so that you can provide something to them, I feel like people would want to support you. And I just, knowing that now, I'm like inspired. I'm like, yeah, this guy's fucking killing it. Give him some fucking bread so he can give him a baguette to dip in his coffee before he starts programming in the morning. You know?
I need my baguette. Oh, that's really nice to hear. Thank you, yeah. Mike. Yeah, maybe I will. You are inspiring me right now. Patreon.
And I hate it when people think that they have to, you know, you don't have to work for free. To some extent, you might have to, but your time is valuable. That's just true. Like, you've already shown people that your time is valuable. You've shown us that you can make a really awesome fucking game. I'm not like, I have a tendency to like bring people on here and be like, yeah, I really like your game. And I do. Like, I never promote anything that I don't really care about. Like I said, I saw screenshots of this game like 8 months ago, and I have been wanting it ever since, and I really, really like it. And I immediately, upon playing the demo, reached back out to you and like, I gotta have you on the show because I really, really like this game.
Glad to hear that. Thanks.
So just being honest about that, I really feel like you're doing yourself a disservice by like not valuing your time, because you can get money. Anybody can make more money. You can't make more time. You're gonna die one day, and you need to enjoy it. You should be going out and having beers with your boys on the week, you know, if you can get a day off from programming. And
Yeah. If I keep doing that, I'll be dead in 5 years, I think. but yeah. That's why I actually realized in the last year, when the game was close to being more polished, I realized, all right, I'm having fun, I'm learning new stuff, and mm-hmm. people like my game. How can I keep that going? And that's the main thing I'm trying to solve right now. Actually balancing, having a better balance between teaching and working on my game, having more people learn about the game. That's just the basic stuff that anybody wants. But yeah, doing Patreon might work.
Doesn't have to be Patreon, but some kind of crowdsourcing.
Patreon, crowdfunding. I think crowdfunding is going to be on the table for the next game, mm-hmm. or even DLC. But it's a bit trashy to ask for money for a DLC for something that's going to make people pay. A bit trashy. The thing is, Patreon. It's always tricky for me personally to start something new, especially something big like Patreon or anything crowdsourcing, because I have a fear of failure. I really, I'm scared of having like putting out the Patreon and having like two patrons, my mom and my dad, for the next 6 months. Like,
I've been through this to where it's like I put it out there and I went through, you know, like the podcast still is not by any means huge. It's not Joe Rogan podcast by any means, but you know, I thought, nah, no one will ever fucking do this, but people kept telling me to do it, and I was like, all right, whatever. And, you know, if you're making a $20 a month is more than not making $20 a month. You know what I'm saying? And then the people slowly over time find out about your thing. It's just that's how the game industry is going to treat you too.
True.
You might put out you might put out Cyberhook.
Yeah.
And it might be a huge fucking failure. You're right. You have every right in the world to fear that, but it will at least you'll have it on your resume. And so then when you go to if you apply for a job somewhere or if you decide to make another game and you have something to show for it. Like, I've done this before. And you may find that years down the road, you work at some other, you know, working on some other project. People are like, oh, this is amazing. What else has this guy made? And then they go back and they find your old games. You're like, fuck, why didn't anybody know about this? And then that could blow up. Like, you gotta... I'm not trying to preach to you, man. Like, I don't want you to fear that your time isn't going to pay off.
Because
I really do believe in, like, if you put in the work, you will see benefits from it later. It's karma.
Yeah.
Like that kind of thing.
Yeah. I actually agree. Yeah. And you know, I haven't told you about the real goal of the project Cyberhook. The idea was, I told you about the one shitty game that we had on Steam and that game's purpose was just to have a game on Steam, and we did it. Yay. $500. But with that experience, we were more confident to go into making Cyberhook, making a full-fledged game. And that's what it is. It's not our final game. It's not our magnus opus. I can say that, I think. If it doesn't work, it's kind of fine. Because we're not depending on it. Like, I did spend cash on it, but I'm not going to die if it makes zero. So it's fine. But the next game that I'm going to prepare, this is going to be a bit more tricky because I made mistakes when working on Cyberhook. I've told people to come work with me and not having the cash and having to take money from my parents to pay them. It was pretty trashy, but I did pay them. But the next game, I'm not going to redo any of those errors. And that's pretty much how you get better. Yeah. You just stop making errors. When there's nothing to throw away, it's kind of good. This game is here to give us experience.
Yeah.
Experience about making a proper game, experience about community management, because I never did that. I never thought that people would be interested in working with me. So now I have like a Discord server with like 300 people on it. How do I manage that? How do I keep them entertained? How do I keep them from leaving the server or just ghosting everyone? Mm-hmm. Those are things I learned day by day.
Yeah.
And the game is also here to teach me about how to recruit publishers. Because, you know, it's something that not many people are familiar with, especially if you don't make games. But publishers are the ones that actually do marketings, do deals with other people in the industry. And there is a way to negotiate with them. So the goal with Cyberhook is just get one publisher. Get a publisher. And we did that with Graffiti, and we were very happy about it. And the next one will have that experience. We know what to expect. We know how to what we bring to the table. We know what they're going to request from us. We know that. So we'll be able to properly negotiate with us,
right,
with them. So yeah, the game, if the game doesn't sell, it's fine. We have that experience, and that's the main thing we wanted in the when making this project. It was not to be famous and make a shit ton of money, but it was to know what we're doing, because that's actually hard to figure out when you are very new into the industry. Well, been working in it for almost 7 years, but it's still new. Because you haven't failed yet, you have not tripped. You need to learn how to get back on your feet and continue to properly work into this industry.
Right.
So that's what we've been doing pretty much, and that's what we expect from the release. It's just falling down and getting back up, because we love doing that. And that's why it's not an industry for everyone, because I remember, I think, when I was studying game design, game development, I remember an indie went into our class and told us, you need to be ready to sacrifice 5 years of your life. And at the time I was like, haha, yeah, not gaining a lot of money. But it is fucking real. For the past 3 years, for me, I've not been paid. And I also plan really to not get paid for the next 2 years, because I'm going to pay myself my teaching, but not with the game, not with the budget we're going to have, just to make my dream, pretty much, make my dream come true, working towards making, being able to make games full time.
Right.
That's pretty much it.
Yeah, hopefully. Let's say you make money, you know, from your teaching gig, and you're able to sustain yourself, and then you can take the money that you make off of Cyberhook and establish your independent company. Like, really, like, now I have a budget to work with. I know what my next game's budget will be, and hopefully sustain that. Yeah, I think that's pretty basic business sense that, for whatever reason, they even apparently in France, they don't really impart on us in school. They just tell us, you know, go to college and get a job and work for the man the rest of your life, but...
Yeah. I didn't know that when starting Cyberhook. It was just a prototype. I wasn't even going to make a game. I was like, I'm having fun. I'm just going with it.
Yeah.
Now I realize managing people, managing your time, managing your resources. Shit, I need to know to make games. That might not be game making, but it's part of the game making toolkit you need.
It all looks good on a resume. Like, managed a team of, you know, however many people they put on here. Like, accomplished X goal, made X money. You have to put it in, like, bullet format. You're like, this is what I accomplished. And when you actually look at it that way, it seems like, oh, wow, I didn't even realize I did all this stuff, you know?
It's a great experience. Never mind the fact that I'm not paying. It's just, I'm just happy. I realized that when I went to my working place, because I work at Azot. I remember... smiling in the metro, and was like, what the fuck are you smiling alone? Yeah. And it dawned on me, I'm happy just going to work. Yeah. Shit. I'm really fucking privileged, because that's awesome. And a lot of people just can't do that. Even though I'm not paid, even though I'm still living in my parents' house. That's awesome.
But you're doing what you love.
Yeah. 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 That's when I think we should be careful about what we're doing, and we should see that when we actually manage to do what we love, we should realize that we're doing that. Because most people I interact with that are making games don't fully realize that, yeah, you're fucking making games for a living. It's awesome. And it's the more I talk about game making, the more just inspired I am, because it's nothing like, I don't know, video making or filmmaking or any kind of artistic endeavor. It's just its own thing, and I love every part of it. Marketing, I love coding, I love art, I love music, I love narrative design, I love everything about it. And I want to keep loving it. So I want to tell myself just, yeah, that, damn boy, you're doing something awesome. Even though you're not as successful as you want to be, but you're still doing it. And I think the idea of being able to keep doing that in the future and maybe getting paid for it, if we're lucky, it's driving me forward. It's a pleasure, always.
You mentioned earlier, like, the, you know, project management and networking and meeting people and learning how to contract everything, but no, truthfully, I think that's probably the most important thing you can do at this stage for both of us, really, is to network and to meet people. Because for all I know, man, I'm talking to you right now in 2020, in 2028, you might be the fucking next Cliff Bleszinski or some shit. I'm just being like, I don't know that. I don't know that you wouldn't be. So it's only, it really benefits me to sit here and just be as cool as humanly possible to you. Not that that's the only reason I'm doing it, but like, treat everybody with kindness, because you never know who you're going to be dealing with down the line. And so
always
at that point, it's 2028. Maybe I'm still scraping by. You're a big millionaire, but you're like, oh, this guy, he was cool to me 8 years ago when I was nothing. I was living in my parents' house. I had no money. And he told me, like, you encourage me and all this kind of shit. And then maybe at that point you come on the show and I get 18 million listens and then my show blows up. Like, it's so important, I think, to just network and meet people and understand. Because,
yeah,
I mean, I'm not a game designer. If you held a gun to my head right now and said, make your computer say hello world, I can't honestly tell you I'd remember how to do it. Like, it's not my gig, but I really like doing, you know, the audio and the talking to people and, you know, I don't even know what to call this whole thing, but I just enjoy talking to people.
It's cool.
Yeah.
It's cool either way. But yeah, that's another thing I'm learning about, networking and shit like that, mm-hmm. because I'm a coder. I'm the archetype of being a fucking geek. Like, I'm fine staying at home. Like, you know, the thing, the new thing, like confinement. Yeah. That was my life for the past two years, pretty much. Yeah. I was like, all right.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm starting to come out of my shell and going out to meet people. That's something I'm still learning to how to do. And yeah, teaching did help me with that. Having to talk to 30 young wankers that don't understand anything. Teaches yourself how to just talk to people. And then look at me right now. I'm speaking in a foreign language on the podcast I wasn't prepared for. But it's going fine. I'm really happy to be there. And I think it's going to go even better in a few years. Oh, about going better in a few years. There's something that boosted my confidence, really, is the fact I can say, right now, I'm trash. Compared to myself in 2 years.
Yeah.
In a year. Yeah. I don't care if you like the game or not. Well, I do care about that, but I don't care if you tell me that, oh, you're so good or you're so bad, because all right, that's your opinion, mate. I don't care, but I know that I'm going to be better later. Since I've been working on Cyborg for 3 years, I can actually go back in time and watch my work unfold in front of me.
Yeah.
That's something only video game can.
You know, a line graph of your skill set, and you can literally look at it. Like, I know I sucked here, and 3 years later I'm here, and so going off that trend, I'll be way up there. And
yeah, I have the old builds that don't look like anything, that are literally unplayable, and at the time I thought, yeah, it's pretty good, but I know I'm shit compared to myself in a year. And every year I thought about that, and every year it was true. It was true that, yes, I was shit 1 year or 2 years ago, and right now I'm still saying it. I'm shit compared to what I will be in a year. Well, at least I hope so. It's been true for the past 3-4 years, and if it keeps going that way, I'm happy that I'm shit. Essentially, I'm happy to be trash right now, but later, I'm going to work towards being better. So hopefully one day I'll reach the point where I can be good enough to have my audience, to have the people watching me and liking my game enough to give me money, essentially, and live off it.
Yeah. So what's it like teaching remotely now? Like, I'm assuming you're not doing in-person classes.
Right now, yeah, for the past 2 months.
Oh, okay.
Because confinement, 3 months, I think. Confinement didn't hit that early. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I've been teaching remotely, and it's trash, complete trash. It's unplayable. It's awful, because you're doing your thing. It's fine. You are showing. You even have even more tools than when you are in class, because you can just switch screens more easily and just interact with the people. But the thing is, people don't give a shit. Really, if you are not in the right mindset to learn and to the right place also to learn, you're not going to do that. And I remember testing my students, just what I was doing a course, like, here's how you you do a light map in Unity, whatever. And if you're listening, just type a poet in chat or anything. And I had like four responses from 30 students, because it's too easy for them to just go on YouTube on fucking Pornhub or anything. So teaching remotely is really hard for anything gaming related, because I can't have everyone having their face cam, because it takes too much space and I can't check for it. But yeah, I really prefer teaching in school. You know, I said, the confinement was my life for the past years. It's true. But in the meantime, when I was teaching, I was actually brought back to my old school. And that always was a breath of fresh air. That's why I realized, that's pretty, being alone, being chilling at home is pretty good. But meeting people is nice too. And the more I'm going forward, the more I'm actually, the more I want to meet people, the more I want to have a drink, with the friends. And we actually did that like three days ago. It was a fucking pleasure. But I am most of the time I'm teaching in real life, I guess. Like I go to my school and I have, the whole class in front of me, which is actually much more interesting because, just being behind a screen does strip me from being able to express myself through I don't know how to say it, through body movement, body, like how what's the term, body language. I use that a lot to convey my teaching, like going up on screen and moving around, stuff like that. You see that it's very important, and when I don't have that, people are not listening as well. So yeah, teaching remotely is trash. No question. Don't at me.
It's just it's not the same. I'm lucky that, we have like at least for the podcast like video technology. Discord like hit right at the perfect time. They implemented this beautiful new like in voice chat video thing, because previously had to be like in a call, or like some people don't want to be on camera, which is fine. I don't mind if people don't want to be on camera, but it's so much so much more human, and we're able to use technology to kind of replicate that human interaction. Like we're not really in the same room right now, but at least it's like as close as we're gonna get without being there. So
yeah, it's pretty cool. Pretty cool.
It's nice, man. I don't know, we live in a very strange time. But
it's true our parents couldn't even do that, and we're like, yeah, sure, I'll talk to someone in California in a day.
Yeah,
in a jiffy.
That's true. It's good. And like I said, with the networking thing, like this was never possible before. So, when you went to school, do you guys like pay to go to college, or is it?
But my school is a private school, but the thing I say to foreigners essentially is it's a private school, but it's a French private school. So like at the time the whole cursus was cursus, I don't know if that's a word, but the whole thing was 80k for the no 18k
courses.
Sorry. The whole 3 years of Izart was 18k, and when we looked at I don't know, like US schools and stuff like that, when it's 18k the year,
that's not the same. Ruined people's, like, people just heard you say that and they're like ready to go jump out the window, I promise you, like, because our schools are insane, because our schools are really expensive, like especially quote good school. It's 18k for 3 years of school sounds outrageous. But
In France, it's already high, and it has gone up a bit higher. I think like now it's 24 or 25 k's for 3 years.
Yeah,
so it's a bit more, but even 30, I don't know. But in France, you can even find, there is, I think, the best school in France called Echemin, which is public. You don't pay shit. And you get the best teachers, you get the best networking, because most of the people working like Ubisoft and stuff like that come from Echemin. That's one thing we bitch about in the industry, because just do Echemin and you have a place in Ubisoft. That's annoying, but that's tricky. That's a dark joke we do to foreigners. Yeah, just if you're American, just come to France, rent a good hotel in France, and have your whole expenses for just the price of going to school in the US. It's crazy, but that's more of a political point that I'm not going to dip my toes in, because I'm just French. But I have no place in doing that.
I think it's interesting though, because did you technical skills for like programming and everything. You probably could have learned that on your own, right? But you just said it yourself, how you go to college and you network and you meet people and you make connections. Now you have a job because you went to that college, right? Like you, that might not have happened. You were able to get your first game on Steam because you went there. For some people, that's not their path. And I think for a lot of Americans right now, it's like, we're not doing that because it's not worth the debt that you go into for it. It's better to just learn how to do skills.
And I clearly understand that. I wouldn't pay for like $60,000 or $80,000 for that. But the idea is schools teach you a lot of stuff, but they don't, they clearly can't teach you everything. But what they give you is time.
Right.
Because not just time to learn, time to work. That's fine. You can, if you're really strict with yourself, you can take this time to yourself and work yourself. But no, the time that they give you is actually lost time. For example, the time I give my my students is the time I've wasted on learning how to do that shit. And maybe, like for example, shaders, like making stuff look pretty in Unity. I've spent like literally 6 months of Cyberhook learning how to do shaders and learning how to make stuff pretty on the on the screen. I can condense that. I can give you my time loss in a two day course. So that's the time you're going to earn.
Is an excellent point. Yeah.
Yeah. That, and there is a lot of things like, yeah, there's a problem. All right, don't do that. Keep going. And every time I fix a bug for a student, I tell them not to do that because they're going to die. It's always my time loss that I avoiding my students. Yeah. And when you're in it, it's understandable that you don't realize it. Just, yeah, you're learning. All right, he told me not to do that. I'm not going to do it. And end of story. But in the end, you're going to gain a lot of time that others have wasted. And since, you know, I told you that my school was in 3 years when I started, and now it's in 4, because we realized that there is a lot of stuff we need to teach. But when I left school, when I finished school, there is a shit ton of stuff that I didn't know how to do, because there is so much to learn when you are one man and want to do everything pretty much in a game. So I did spend a lot of time just trying. And if I had somebody next to me telling me, no, stop that shit. Don't do multiplayer on a single player game. You're going to die.
Yeah.
I want to tell people that. Don't do that. But that would have saved me like 6 months. Like that. 6 months, I think 6 months of work won, pretty much. Earned. And that's the real power of schools. Just avoiding time loss. And that's something that when you're alone, you're going to have to learn to do by yourself. And it's extremely hard. I myself struggle with it. It's really hard to avoid time loss.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely correct. It's like an angle of it that I think a lot of people might want to consider too, because you can just beat your head against a wall forever and end up learning later that it was such a simple thing. Or it could even just be, like you're talking about confidence. Like that. I see that a lot with people that I like work with is like when they first do it, they're afraid to make a decision and just go with it. You know, especially when it comes to like weather stuff, because it's like, oh no, there's a tornado going to hit this town. Should I put out the warning? I don't even know if it's going to happen. I'm like, I don't know, but you better make a decision because you have 10 minutes to do it.
Shit.
Well, it's like for you guys, it's like you have to like kind of make these long-term plans. Like, well, is it worth spending 6 months of my life trying to make a multiplayer that perhaps no one will even play? Or should I focus on this particular part of the art project, you know?
Yeah, and at the time, you don't even know that it's going to take 6 months because that's the first time you're going to do it.
Right.
And that's another thing. If you have a problem, that's something I tell my students in French, but I think I can translate it. When the only thing you have is a hammer, all your problems are nails.
Yeah, yeah, that's it.
Pretty much it.
Exactly, verbatim, that's an English saying. People say exactly that. Yeah.
There you go. That's I knew it. But it's when you don't really know how to do properly your work, you're going to do as best as you can. And again, it's going to result in time loss. Mm-hmm. It's going to result in headaches and stuff like that. And one of the other things I learned this 3 years on Cyberhook is actually making the right decisions at the moment you need them. Like when at the start of the project, when I just was making a crappy prototype, I thought, all right, I know this, it's going to be trashy, but I need to make it as clean as possible. And 3 years later, I'm able to go back to that same code, to that same work, and say, all right, it's still usable, it's still fine, and it's not giving me more problems. But when you're starting, being alone or in school, you're going to just make mistakes. It's absolutely imperative that you make mistakes just to learn, but you're not a genius. Nobody is born knowing how to code. And when you have a teacher behind you, they're going to tell you that right away, no, don't do that. Don't do that because it's going to give you trouble when you try to do that. It's going to give you trouble if you try to share your code with somebody else. So like that, you'll have more tools. And the more tools you have, the better of a decision you can make when you are presented with a new problem.
Right.
And that's another big thing about schools. That really help instead of just working out yourself.
Another thing to consider is that you're going to have this actual network of several students over years of time that you taught, and they're going to come out of college hungry to get into the gaming industry and looking for cheap labor. It seems like it only benefits you. Like, hey, you were a pretty good student. You know what? I need somebody to do level design. You're on it. You know, I remember you being pretty good at sound shit. Get over there and start making sounds.
That's actually one of my problems because I was very, very young. Well, very young. I was 18 when I started the school, as young as I called, pretty much. So I, at the time, I was very much introvert. So I made a few friends. Six or seven. It's pretty good. But if I had to do it now, I would be friends with every fucking body because you have to do that. And that's another problem that I'm having right now is that half of my class just dropped out. Half of my class is trash and half of my class is already in a good position in the industry. So when I need somebody, it's kind of tricky to find people to recruit. Luckily, I'm still in the indie industry, so I have the "it's a cool game" option to bring to the table. When you go to school, you make a shit ton of contacts, being your students, your fellow students, or your teachers. It's awesome. It's really something that you can't get anywhere. But it doesn't. It's not worth $80,000.
I think everybody has their own path, man. Some people literally have to go that they can't have someone to teach them. They have to go through that process of banging their head against the brick wall until it breaks, and then they learn their lesson.
That's something I actually enjoy doing, beating your head until you break through. Breakthrough is awesome, and you learn to do it properly more as you go along. Like maybe not use your head, but use a hammer. Think the wall is a nail.
You need both. You need outsiders and you need institutional people. You need the people who have learned it the proper way, and then you need someone to come in and be like, oh, that way that has been the systematic best way that's been taught all along, I just figured out a way that you don't even have to do that. You can save yourself a bit more time or learn a new skill.
And the other thing that some people might not be confident about what they're doing and stuff like that, I sure wasn't when I started. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, if we really had a book, a Bible about how to be successful in anything, in devs, dev making, or in meteorology.
There are lots of books available.
It does apply to more creative jobs, but being a good artist or being a good singer, a good dev. If we had a book on just how to do it, we would give it to you, and we would read it ourselves. There are none because everyone is kind of special, I guess, in this industry. I do minimalist retrowave style games for now, but I know my friends are doing super cute mobile games that are actually working. And I know that they Atomic Horn, I'm just name dropping. They know the guy that made, you know, maybe Piku Niku. It's a small indie game released by Devolver. When we saw that, we were so fucking jealous. But it's you are like a little ball with legs, and you walk around, you push things around. Well, they have a friend in the team. The main guy that made the game is actually a friend of a friend. So it's a really small industry. But can anyone really tell him, no, don't make a game about silly, small rounds with legs? That won't ever work. It did. Shut the fuck up. Look at, I don't know, I'll take the example of Toby Fox again. Look at Undertale. It's just, technically, it's kind of ugly. It's very simple. But the story is so well written. The characters are so well written that, yeah, I don't care. I'll make a Earthbound style game. Just fuck you.
So you say it's ugly, but I literally love.
I love it. I love
ZX
it.
ZX Spectrum Amiga era graphic, like that. The way the game functions, like that's such perfect thing.
Yeah, I'll backdash on that statement. The art style. I think it's actually glorious. The animations are glorious in fights and stuff. But if you really take the main character and shit like that, they make the joke in the game. Actually, you look like a lamp. It's pretty much very simplistic. When you walk, you have two frames. It's not really polished in that way, but the whole universe being centered around the same art style makes it work extremely well. So yeah, that's the idea. What I meant was just do your shit, do your thing. It can work, but the big thing is going to evolve. We forget that Toby Fox has been working on Undertale for I think 2 years or 3 years, something kind of like me on Cyberhook. But he worked on other things before that were completely unknown, like Earthbound mods and stuff like that. People just didn't give a shit because they didn't knew about it. Yeah. They didn't know about it. And when Undertale released, he kept doing his thing and it worked. It doesn't mean that it will always do that. And your thing needs to improve with time. That's what I'm trying to do.
Michelangelo made some shit statues before, you know, like it's just always true. Like Miles Davis played some sour notes in his life, you know. Beethoven wrote some shit symphonies that never saw the light of day, and we just
And that's the big thing that you just said. They never see the light of day. I am never going to show you my first games ripping off from left and right assets that I found on the internet. They're trash, and you'll never know about that. You don't even know right now the first game I released on Steam, and I think it's trash. And maybe, hopefully, if Cyberhook works, they're going to know me for Cyberhook, not the shit before. And if Cyberhook doesn't work, it's fine. They know me for the next thing that I'm going to do. And yeah, people think we're all just finite in every work we put out. But it's not the thing that we're going to remember. We're going to remember the good shit. Mm-hmm. Always. For individuals, at least. We're going to remember, like, I don't know, the music that was in that movie. We're going to remember this drawing that was featured in this game. We're not going to remember the shitty-ass drawing you were doing like two or 3 years ago. It's fine. It's fine to fail. Oh, yeah. Just thinking about it. It's really, really fine to fail. I prefer failing than succeeding without knowing why. Because when you fail, you can actually see that is trash, that is trash, that is trash. Remove it. And the more you do that, the more flawless your work is going to become. Because when you remove the flaws, you just have something good most of the time.
Can you imagine being like a stand-up comedian where the only way to do your art is in front of people and every failure is in front of people?
That's my fucking nightmare, yeah. Yeah. Being in front of people is fine, but having to make them laugh and then them not doing so, it's awful. Yeah. Though I saw a few documentaries about random French comedians, and the thing is, you can actually bounce back from failures much better than having a tepid, I think, a weird joke. Because when it's really trash, when nobody laughs, Yeah, we can hear that even in the audience. Like, all right, that was trash. Scratch that. Kill yourself. Stuff like that. You can bounce back from anything like that. But yeah, me in front of people, like, we've been to conventions, stuff like that. Being in front of someone of even like 10 people is fine. I can talk about that. But me being in public, oh my God, that's a fear of mine. But I think I'll get over it someday.
One day you're going to be at like a gaming convention and people are going to be like, oh my God, you made Cyberhook and you made that other game that you don't talk about, but I found out about. And they're going to be excited to meet you and you're probably going to have to give a speech or some shit. You never know, dude. I'm just saying. Like,
yeah, talking to people is fine. Yeah, talking to people is fine. You tell me you like my game, like, awesome, let's grab a drink. I don't know. But being like in front of 200 people and be like, I make the video game. That's all. Good day.
Yeah,
that's kind of scary. But that's a skill I can get. That's a skill I can practice through teaching. Haha, big brain. I knew it all along.
I think you're really well set up, man, and I really love Cyberhook. The current standing demo is absolutely fantastic. I hope people go out and download the shit out of it right now. It's I can't say it enough, man. So cool. What's
Thank you.
What else is in store? You got anything you want to say before we get out of here?
Well, you can join the Discord, maybe. But other than that, yeah, keep hooking, keep being hooked by the game. That's all I ask.
All right. Well, I need to go get a refill on this Le Jeu du Soc, and that'll be that. So, thanks, man. Thanks for coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you for having me. It was a great time. Really happy to be here.
Thank you to Teo for being a part of the show. Really appreciate all of his time and effort. And if you haven't already, I definitely recommend get your ass over right now to the Steam page for Cyberhook. Download that shit and play it because you will absolutely enjoy it. I'm so serious. Obviously, thank you to everyone who is listening right now. If you've made it to the end of the podcast, you're a fucking trooper. We appreciate the hell out of you. The best way that you can support the show is obviously just to listen and share. Go on your social media sites, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, whatever the fuck it is, and tell people that you like the show. If you happen to see it on an app that you like, or you know, on Reddit or whatever, upvote that shit, leave a review, like, whatever the hell. It doesn't matter, man. Your support is greatly appreciated. If you want to go the extra mile and do a little bit of extra supporting, you know what I'm saying? We would greatly appreciate that. You can go to inthekeep.com and check out our support tab. There are several different options, including our Amazon affiliate link, which is of no cost to you. And no matter what you buy, if you do your shopping through that link, we will get a little bit of a kickback from it. So that's really fucking cool. I like that. You can also, you know, just, you know, become a Patreon supporter. You can go to our PayPal link and just drop us a tip if that's what you want to do. Whatever works for you, man. We'll figure out more ways to do that in the future. But also, there's our merch tab. If you want to go on Redbubble and pick up one of our sweet t-shirts. We also have multiplayer Doom Federation t-shirts and now brand new In the Keep mask for when you're styling and profiling out there on the streets, keeping everybody safe from your nasty face, or if you just want to cover up your face because you're ugly as fuck, that's cool too. No judgment, but there are masks available with our logo on it. I think they're pretty cool. At the end of the show, I'm going to go ahead and read off a few of the people who have been amazing and given back to the show. So I want to say thank you to Dots, Moose, Paul, Zach, Alexander, Lashaka, Brad, Night Owl, Tones, Jeffrey, Larissa, Nave, Steve, NVZ, Catman, Semiko, Chibi Sniper, Donkey, VJ Tenjin, Hadoukant, Brandflakes, Moleketrerao, Red Eyes Green Dragon, Anthony, Robert, Vince, and Morpher, and Igrax Simon. You are all fantastic, amazing, and greatly appreciated. Thank you so much for everything that you've done for this whole project, not just the show, but our streams and everything. God, I'm going to ramble on forever. Till next time, guys, stay in the keep.